people joining our family here at Skyline. Man, I tell you, it's like we're on fire, you know, and it just keeps spreading, and it's a wonderful thing. And, you know, that's how it's supposed to be.
Amen.
That's how it's supposed to be. As the church, this is what we're supposed to be doing. Matthew 28, where Jesus left that great commission to go and evangelize and teach and baptize, we're supposed to be bringing people to Jesus Christ so that he can add them to his church. And so I want to challenge each of you, keep it up. Let's keep it up. Let's keep doing our thing here and keep growing the Lord's church. Hope you have your Bibles with you this morning. We're going to be turning to a number of different passages that we'll look at. You can turn through all of these with me as we study this morning. You know, if we wanted to take specific verses from God's Word, we could actually paint a pretty terrible picture in some cases. You know, we could look and we could see some scary, really terrifying stuff, especially for us. Look at Romans chapter 3, 23, which most of you have probably heard numerous times. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Everybody has sinned. Well, what happens? What's the result? What's the consequence of that? Well, Isaiah chapter 59, 1 to 2 says, "Behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, or his ear dull that it cannot hear. But your iniquities, your sins, have made a separation between you and your God. And your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear." Turn to Isaiah chapter 64. Isaiah chapter 64. What we're looking at here is really, literally the most terrifying thing we can ever imagine that's possibly imaginable, okay? Being separated from the God, the only God that can save us from hell. That's the most terrifying thing ever, right? I don't want to be separated and completely away from God who can save me, and the only being that can save me. Isaiah chapter 64 and verses 5 through 7 says about the Israelites there with Isaiah prophesying, "You meet him who joyfully works righteousness, those who remember you in your ways. Behold, you were angry and we sinned. In our sins we have been a long time, and shall we be saved? We have all become like one who is unclean." This is what sin does, right? This is the results of sin. "We have been become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a polluted garment." Some versions say like dirty rags. So, you know what sin does when you're living in sin? Do you do some good stuff? Well, sometimes, maybe. You know, maybe I'm righteous over here in these ways, but I can't get rid of that one sin because I just want to hold on to it. I'm not willing to repent. I'm not willing to throw it out of my life, right? You know what it says? We're become like a polluted garment. We're like dirty rags when we do that. We can't be righteous and sinful at the same time. We can't be living in sin and claim to be righteous. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, our sins like the wind take us away. They take us away from God. "There is no one who calls upon your name who rouses himself to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have made us melt in the hand of our iniquities." It is because of our sin. It's the most terrifying thing. And I don't know why. Well, it's because society, it's because the world, it's because Satan wants you to think it's really not that bad. It's really okay. Because it seems like it's fun sometimes. And it seems like, well, everybody else is doing it and I'm not that bad. Right? And so ultimately we live in a world where sin is really just okay. And so because of that, our mind goes that way if we're not careful. When in fact, if I'm living in that, it's pretty scary. Maybe I need to wake up and realize that. But it's not because God doesn't have the power. to save us from that, right? It's not because God can't. It's because I have hid him from me in my sins. His very nature can't be around wickedness. It can't be around sin. Our sin causes that division between us and God, our separation. Romans chapter 6, verses 10 through 11 says, Romans 6, 10 through 11, "For the death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus." We don't have company with God in sin. It's just not possible. God can't be around us when we are living in sin. He is separated from us, not because of him, but because of me. He can't be accompanied with sin. And Romans 6:23 tells us the wages of that sin leads to my spiritual death, leads to that separation from God. And notice 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9. 2 Thessalonians 1 and verse 9. Ultimately, what happens? The day of judgment comes. 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 9 says, "They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction." There it is. "Away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might." So now, here it is. Judgment day has come. I've had my chance. I've had time to prepare myself. I've had time to make my life right with God. I've had time to die to sin and turn to God, right? But no, my sin has kept me away from God. And now, punishment of eternal destruction forever, eternity, always away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might. Now, man, how terrible is that? Because of our iniquities, our sinfulness, we all have, right? We have all sinned. Everyone would deserve hell and death, and there wouldn't be anything we could do about it. But thanks to God, that's not all Scripture reads, right? So we don't just read about those terrifying verses that because we're in sin, that's it. There's no hope. That's not what we read. We can read other verses. Ephesians 1, verse 7. John Austin read for us a moment ago. "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to what? According to the riches of his grace." See, God's grace. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son." There's the grace. "He gave his only son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life." Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. You might want to go ahead and put a marker in Ephesians, because Paul teaches us a lot about grace. And that's what we're going to look at a lot this morning. The fact that we need God's grace. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. "Grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift." See, God loves you so much that even though we have all sinned against him, even though we deserve death, right? The wages of sin is death. We've all sinned. He has made his grace accessible to us. Now think about how great that picture is. Because even though we read about that eternal punishment of destruction and hell, completely away from God because of sin, and we all have sinned, so honestly, we deserve that because we mess up. We sin against God. God's grace is there to help us, to save us. Now, understanding grace, look up. If you look up the word grace in the dictionary, you might find the definition, unmerited favor, right? And so, ultimately, God has given us favor even though we don't deserve it. God has given us life, has saved us, even though we don't deserve that. And maybe we can take it even farther in saying that God has given us favor. He has justified us. He's given us approval, even though, honestly, we deserve hell because we are sinners and we have sin. But see, that's what God's grace is. And he did that through his perfect Son, Jesus Christ. Do we need God's grace? Absolutely. Absolutely we do. And so why do we need God's grace? Several points that I want us to look at this morning. And I hope you'll turn with me in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. We need God's grace because without it, we are completely hopeless. Look at verse 1 of Ephesians chapter 2. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. We've all been there. Every one of us have been there. And here it is. I love the next two words, okay? Verse 4. But God. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that it is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. And so, sometimes, you know that sometimes people in the church, this is a tough passage sometimes. It seemed like that in the church, right? Because what do we preach all the time? Well, you've got to be baptized, right? We preach that. Well, you've got to repent. You've got to obey. Well, wait a second. Paul says here, for by grace you have been saved through faith, that this is not your own doing, it's the gift of God. What, which is it? We're going to work that out this morning. We're going to see. First of all, we need God's grace because I'm here to tell you, don't be afraid to say it. God's grace is what saves you. God's grace saves me. Because you see, I have sinned, just like what we read in Ephesians chapter 2, the first couple of passages. There's a point in my life where I was going after my own worldly desires and passions, and I was living in sin. Right? What saved me from that? God's grace saved me from that. Through Jesus Christ. Because there's nothing that I could ever do in my life that would make me worthy or deserving of God's grace. It's unmerited favor. Okay? In fact, I deserve right the opposite. Because I have messed up. And I do mess up. And I have sinned. Point is, I haven't and will never do anything to deserve eternal life and salvation, right? But see, God's grace, but God. We are saved because of God's grace. We have the opportunity of eternal life because of God's grace, because God was so willing to send his only Son, John 3:16, for us, Jesus Christ, coming to this earth, living a perfect life, dying on the cross, being raised from the dead, defeating sin. That is where we see God's grace, because Jesus Christ went to the cross bearing all sin. 2 Timothy chapter 1. Look at 2 Timothy chapter 1. Verses 8 through 10 says, therefore do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God, who saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, okay, but because of his own purpose and grace. There it is again. Which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began, and which now has been manifested through the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. There it is. I want you to go back to Romans chapter 3. Romans chapter 3. And we hang on to verse 23 a lot. And it's such a staple verse. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Verse 23 there. And are justified by what? Are justified by his grace as a gift. Through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. God's grace says, don't be afraid to say it. Okay? God's grace is what saves me. We have all sinned. God has made a way for the faith to be justified. We should never underestimate that. We don't need to underestimate the power of God's to save us. Every picture that we see through reading about the consequences of sin, we also, right on the flip side of that, have wonderful pictures through Scripture of Jesus Christ saving us and giving his life. The most beautiful picture that God loves us, has mercy on us, and gives us his grace. We need God's grace because it saves. It's the only thing that can save you and I. Number two, we need God's grace because it is sufficient. Hope that you'll turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. We need God's grace because it is sufficient. Do you ever feel insufficient? Do you ever feel weak? Do you ever have a time in your life, or your Christian life, or your physical life, whatever it may be, where you're weak, where you feel like you're struggling, where you feel like you can't get ahead, where you feel like you're behind for some reason? You can't catch a break. Maybe there's some temptation that you have, and you're just like, I can't get away from it. Every time I turn the corner, it's there. It's popping up in front of me. You want to stay away from it, but there it is. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 through 10. See, we read of a time in Paul's life where this exact thing was going on. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. It says, three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. Paul's got something going on, right? He's got a weakness in there. Something that he just can't get away from. And he's pleaded with the Lord three different times, please take this away from me. But you know how God responds to him? He said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weakness. Here's what Paul says, okay? Because of Christ's love, because of that grace that is sufficient for us, Paul says, I'm content with weakness, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I'm weak, says then I'm strong. Because that's what God's grace does for us. You notice it never says exactly what Paul's thorn in the flesh was. I think that's to our benefit, honestly. Because I think that we can all take application from it. We all have that thorn in the flesh. We all have something that we struggle with from time to time. We all have those times where we feel like we can't catch a break. We have hardships. We're being persecuted from one way or the other. But God's grace is sufficient. Man, what a wonderful thing that is. I understand God's grace being sufficient obviously isn't a sin-free card, right? That's not what we're saying. We're not saying that because of God's grace, I can just do what I want, which is what a lot of the religious world will tell you today. Many in the religious world think that once you have God's grace, there's no getting away from it, right? We're going to look later at how the Bible literally says you can fall from grace and has told people that. It's not a sin-free card. God hates sin. God hates wickedness. Again, God can't be around it, right? Doesn't mean we can go sin and do anything that we've wrong. Romans 6, 1 to, verses 1 to 2, I think Paul describes this here in Romans very well, where he says, what shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? Is that what we're supposed to do? So because we have grace, hey, now we can go sin all we want, right? Because grace is covered. Is that how it works? He says, by no means. No. That's not what it's about. How can, and here's where he says, how can we who died to sin still live in it? We know that as long as we're walking in the light, 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, if we are walking in the light as he is in the light, and we are being obedient to God, his grace is sufficient for us. His grace saves us. Whenever you feel weak, whenever you're struggling, whenever you feel like you can't catch a break, remember that. God's grace is sufficient. You are strong in your weakness because of God's grace. We need God's grace because it saves us. We need God's grace because it is sufficient for us. And the last point that I want us to look at this afternoon is that we need God's grace because it teaches us and it trains us. Titus chapter 2. Turn with me to Titus chapter 2. A lot of people that don't fully understand, and honestly, it can go all the way back to like we read about Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, where he says, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge, right? That's why we have so many different thoughts today. Because people don't take the time to study God's Word. That's ultimately what it is. You hear something, hey, that sounds good to me. Let's roll with it, okay? Because, you know, how good does it sound to say, hey, God's grace covers you. You can go live how you want, brother. Go do whatever you want to. Woo. That'd be the easiest thing we could ever imagine, right? Why would I want to study God's Word when that's what people are telling me? If I could live like that, man, that's the easiest thing. That's not how it works. We can't ignore Scripture. We got to study. So many people are being destroyed still to this day, thousands of years later, because of a lack of knowledge, because they don't want to study God's Word. We need God's grace because it teaches us. Titus 2, verses 11 to 15 says, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people. There's that grace, right? Training us. Wait a second. God's grace trains us. Training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, to live self-controlled, upright, godly lives in this present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness, to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. See, those are the people who are saved by God's grace. Those who are redeemed from lawlessness. Those people who are zealous for good works, who are being trained to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, to live self-controlled, godly lives in this present age. That's who we're talking about. Declare these things, exhort and rebuke with all authority, let no one disregard you. But wait a second. Hold on. Because we just got through looking in Ephesians chapter 2 where it says it's not of my own doing, right? It's not of my works. How does this work out? You look back at Romans chapter 3, this will be the third or fourth time we've gone to this. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. Maybe you called it a moment ago. But he says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and we're justified how? By his grace as a gift, right? That's how we are saved. We are saved by the grace of God, justified by his grace as a gift through what? Through the redemption, right, that we find in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood. Wait a second. How is it preached? How do we receive that? Does that make sense? So there's God's grace. It's a free gift. Jesus Christ died on the cross. How do we get to it? Okay? What do I need to do to get there? To be received by what? Received by faith. What is faith? Faith, belief. So if you have faith, you believe. I think it's more than belief, right? When we read about in the Old Testament, we read about Abraham and his great faith. How did you know Abraham had great faith? Because of the way he lived, right? When God said, Abraham, I want you to take Isaac up on the mountain. I want you to sacrifice him. What did Abraham do? He said, God, I have faith. And so because of that faith, there was action. And faith and action go hand in hand. James says, the devils believed and trembled. Did they receive that grace? Because of simply believing? No. Belief accompanied with action is what we read about in the New Testament to be faith. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9. Go to Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9. Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 9. And being made perfect, Jesus Christ, he became the source of eternal salvation. There it is, okay? He became the source from his death on the cross, his sacrifice, his resurrection. Right? That grace that we're talking about is because of Jesus. He became the source of salvation, eternal salvation to who then? All who obey. Right. So you see, God's grace is there. And it's absolutely what saves us. But I have to go get it. Through obedience. Through faith. God wants and expects it. He wants and expects obedience in return. If it was the case that there wasn't a condition upon accessing God's grace, then every soul would have it, right? And therefore would be saved. Because if there's no condition placed upon it, then, you know, passages like Matthew 7:13, where it says that wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, there's many that go therein. Wait a second, God's grace can cover everybody. You don't have to do anything, right? That doesn't make sense. Narrow is the gate, few that are that go into the way of life. James chapter 4, verse 6 says, but he gives more grace. But what does he do? Therefore it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace. Who does he give grace to? The humble. How do I show humility? How do I show a humble attitude toward God? I completely submit my will to his. He expects obedience from you and from me. And for me to reach that grace that can save all of mankind, I have to obey. I have to have faith. I have to be willing to repent and live exactly as God has asked us to in his New Testament law. That's how it all comes together. His grace teaches us to live as God would have us to live. Because of God's grace, see, here it is. If we have penitent hearts, if we're willing to repent from sin, if we are obedient, the blood of Jesus Christ continually cleanses us, and there it is. We need God's grace because it saves, because it's sufficient for us, and because it teaches us and trains us. be obedient to God. And that begins with, as we conclude here today, what does that begin with? It begins with hearing and studying God's Word, Romans 10:17. Faith comes from hearing, and hearing from the Word of God. And once we believe, that sets forth action. Mark 16:16. And we will have the commitment, right, that is brought with us to repent from sin. Romans chapter 6, I think, lays out a great picture there of what it is to be a Christian and being dead to sin, that we are burying our sin in baptism, right? We are doing away with it, and when we are coming up and we are resurrected from the water, we are a new person, a new creature, right? Repentance, Luke 13:3-5, without it, says, I tell you, nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. Without repentance, we're going to perish, right? Confession, Romans 10:9. And then Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins. This is where it all begins. It all begins right here. And it's an act of obedience to God so that we can reach that grace that saves. Once we do that, what do? We live a holy, obedient, humble life to God, completely submitting our will to His. Galatians chapter 5:4. A moment ago, we talked about so many the religious world today that they want to claim that God, once you have God's grace, there's no, you're good. Can't fall away from it. In fact, we see that a man by the name of Demas, who once walked and preached and talked with Paul, later on fell away from that and was no longer with them. Galatians 5:4 says, you are severed from Christ. Now, to be severed from Christ, does that not mean that at one point you must have been with Him? You are severed from Christ. You who would be justified by the law, you have fallen away from grace. It's possible. When does that happen? Obviously, when I decide that I don't have to submit my will to God anymore. And when I decide that whatever that sin is in my life, it's more important to me. Therefore, I'm not going to repent. When I quit confessing Jesus as my Lord and Savior because I'm putting more other things of more importance to Him. See, we're called to be obedient to God to reach that grace. We can fall from it. So we have the opportunity this morning to, the Lord's invitation is always open. If you have need this morning to come, and maybe you've been studying, you have the desire to put on Christ in baptism, we want to encourage you to do that, and we can study with you if you'd like to study. Whatever the case may be, we would love to study with you. Or maybe you find yourself this morning, and look, we need self-examination, right? Maybe you've done that this morning, and you find yourself in a position where you are completely separated from God again. You have fallen from that grace because of sin that remains in your life. You have the desire to get rid of that this morning. Again, it's the most terrifying thing we could ever imagine. So don't wait if that's the case. We as your brothers and sisters in Christ, we understand, okay, and we want to help you in any way that we can. We'll pray for you and pray with you. If you're subject in any way this morning, won't you come as we stand and we sing the song.
Yeah. 64 will be our next song. We'll sing this song and compare our minds to the taking of the Social Security. 769. Let us sing.
When we meet in sweet communion,
John 19 and verse 28, Christ